Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you our hearts will praise. Through you their darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. I am free. I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
I am free to live for you.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free.
Through you the kingdom comes. Through you the battle's won. Through you I'm not afraid. Through you the price is paid. Through you there's victory. Because of you my heart screams, I am free. I am free.
Come on, church.
I am free to run. Sun sets free, is free indeed.
Come on, church, let me hear you.
Who the sun sets free, is free indeed. Who the sun sets free, is free indeed.
One, two, one, two.
I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
I am free to live for you.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free.
I am free.
Church, get them hands up.
When the doubt in my way tries to steal what you say, saying I have no reason to praise, I will give thanks. I will give thanks. When the roar that I hear is the voice of my fear, trying to silence this hope in my heart, I will give thanks. Oh, I will give thanks. A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I will dance in your kindness and claim every yes and amen. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I will shout of your goodness forever again and again. When it's all stripped away and it seems it's too late, hope is buried and dead in the grave, I'll speak your name. I'll speak your name. song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
Come on.
I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I will dance in your kindness and claim every yes and amen. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, I will shout of your goodness forever again and again.
Come on, church.
The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I'll never stop, no, I'll never stop, no, nothing can stop my praise. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I'll never stop. Never stop, no, nothing can stop my praise. I will rejoice, I will rejoice. I will dance in your kindness and claim every yes and amen. I will rejoice. Shout of your goodness forever again and again. Oh, I will shout of your goodness forever again and again.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you.
Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom. He canceled my debt and he called me friend. When death was arrested and my life began.
Come on!
Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made begins with you.
Whoa.
displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began.
Was blind, but now I Thank you for hearing our prayers, Lord, and thank you for this moment that we have the opportunity to open the Bible and look at a story that is familiar to us all, but Lord, may it never become so familiar to us that we lose the glory of what happened in this story and in the lives of the people who are a part of this story. We pray today that you would make your presence known in our lives, that, Lord, truly you would reach in and touch us where we are, and that you would bring us close to yourself, that we might have everything that we need at this time in our lives. Thank you for everyone who's gathered here. Thank you for those who are watching online. Lord, just thank you for what you are doing in these days as we simply try to humbly answer the call that you've placed on our lives. We love you, and we thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm going to take you to the 11th chapter of John today, and those who read the Bible and have studied the Bible for years know that that's the chapter where we're told about the occasion when Lazarus died and Jesus showed up and raised him from the grave. And we're going to look at this story and pray that God will use it in our lives to help us to understand that while none of us knows what's going to happen tomorrow, we can know that God is in our tomorrows, and whatever we need, God will provide in that moment that we need his touch. And even death cannot keep God from working the miracles that he is wanting to work in our lives. And so this is a hallmark moment, if you will, in the scripture when Jesus goes to Bethany and stands at the entrance of the tomb of his dear friend Lazarus. He's standing there with Mary and Martha, who are the sisters of Lazarus, and they are wrought, as you can imagine. Any of us who have stood by the graveside of a loved one know what they were feeling. It's a very tender time. It's a tearful time. It's a hurtful time. So many things that we wish we could alter in those moments, but God shows up and does what only God can do in the lives of his people in the face of such scenes. I've been reading a little devotional book that started out dealing with the Sermon on the Mount, and then the second part of the book deals with the miracles of Jesus, and this is one of the miracles that is highlighted in that little devotional book, and I'm thankful for the many things that God can do in our lives as we pay attention to these kinds of happenings in Scripture. And so I pray that the Holy Spirit will quicken it to our lives, because he'll say to one person one thing and he'll emphasize something else to another person. And only God understands exactly what we need to hear from this story. And I pray that we will be able to receive what he has for us. So I'm going to start reading with verse 17, I'm going to read down through verse 25, then I'm going to skip over to verse 38 and read a few more verses from there. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died, but I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life." And just to pause for a second, a couple of things. Martha goes out to greet Jesus. The first thing she says to him is what any of us would have said: "Jesus, where were you? If you had been here in his moment of sickness, he would still be alive." And we've all had those moments when we wonder, God, why didn't you, right? I mean, we're all on common ground there. We've all had those moments when God's ways are beyond what we understand. And we're sure that if he had only shown up when he needed to show up, things would be better. And that's how she's feeling. Now, notice it says something, but Mary stayed at the house. Now, what that means is she was really upset with Jesus. Jesus is out here. Martha goes on out. Mary says, I just can't talk to him right now. I just can't. I can't do it. I'll say something ugly, and I'd rather just stay here than to say something that later on I'll regret. And we know, because of what Scripture teaches us, Jesus knew what she would have said if she had showed up in that moment. He already knew it. But she said, "I'm just going to stay here at the house." And so Jesus says, "Martha, everything's going to be all right." And Martha says, "Well, I know in the last day that he will rise." And so for Martha and for the people in that moment, they saw the working of God tied to a day on the calendar. That it will happen at that moment. Jesus was about to give them a breakthrough teaching. He said resurrection is not attached to a date. It's attached to a person. And I am the resurrection and the life. And I'm going to show you that his opportunity to live and your opportunity to live does not have to do with some distant day on the calendar that is a mystery to you, but what I am going to do is attached to the fact that I am here and I can reach into this moment and I can absolutely alter what has happened. Now, before he went, if you go back to the beginning of chapter 11, Jesus is talking with his disciples and they have received word that Lazarus is sick, that he is sick unto death, which means if something doesn't happen, he's not going to be in this world much longer. And Jesus tells his disciples, "Don't worry about Lazarus. He's only asleep. He will rise up from his sleep." Well, the disciples thought, "Jesus, what are you not understanding? He's not sleeping. He's on his way to death." Listen, death is like sleep in the hands of the Lord. What we think is the end is not the end. Because God can reach in and do miraculous things in the face of any circumstance in this life. We all know that one day we are going to rise up. I love to tell this story. I've told it too many times, but I was having a wedding down in the Low Country, and we were at this place where a man by the name of Reverend Bull is entombed there, and the vault is up above the ground, the lid's on the vault. They decided for that wedding they were going to use that as the preacher's platform. So I was to stand on Mr. Bull's tomb, which was about 2 feet out of the ground, and I was to perform the wedding from there. And the wedding director said, "Preacher, is that all right?" I said, "Well, I don't know." I said, "If the trumpet sounds, I'm going to go flying when this lid comes off." How many of y'all believe the graves are going to open up one day? Amen. They are going to open up one day. Jesus says, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Skip down to verse 38. Jesus, once more deeply moved. Man, I am so glad that our Savior is moved in our behalf. That He is a Savior who has great compassion for us. He understands the trying scenes of life. He's walked on this planet. He knows what it is to feel what we feel. He knows what it is to go through the circumstances of a human existence. He knows that because Jesus was fully human while He was fully God. And it says, once more, Jesus, deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Those of you who've been to the Holy Land, you've got that picture in your mind when we went to the garden tomb, and we can see that in our minds. And so there was a stone that was rolled across the entrance. Jesus, standing there, looked to those who were there with Him and said, take the stone away. Someone who had a little bit of bravery, if you will, and it's Martha again, says, but Lord, the sister of the dead man, but Lord, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been in there for 4 days. How many times have we had a situation in which we said, I know God can do anything, but Lord, how many times have I said that? But Lord. And Jesus says, Ron, just trust me. Just trust me. Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they, whoever they is, some of His disciples, some of the other mourners gathered around there. So they took away the stone. And my mind is always searching what these verses look like in real life. I see someone makes a move. I don't know who made the first move, but whoever made the first move is an A personality, is a driven personality to some extent. And they make a move toward the stone, and they don't see any shadows moving with them. So what did that person do next? Y'all, come on. Come on, let's move the stone. I remember one time, the first house Becky and I bought, just a little house, and that little house needed a new little roof. And the people who were selling the house to us agreed that we could put the roof on. It would cost them less, and my type A personality, I wanted the roof done the way I wanted the roof done, and I knew my brother-in-law was a good roofer, and he would do it that way. We went up on the roof, we tore the shingles off, we tore the black paper. What it did next, it started raining. If you need rain on your garden, go tear somebody's roof off. It'll rain. And it started raining, and we hadn't taken all the black paper off. We had taken it off on one piece of the roof. And so my mind is, we need to get the black paper up here and cover this back up. And my brother-in-law said, Becky's brother said, let's pray. And so we prayed. And I can't remember who led us in prayer, but they said, Lord, here we all are. We need to do this roof. It won't take that long. If you would, Lord, just let us be able to do this roof today. Let this cloud pass over. And so the amen was spoken, and I looked to Tom, my brother-in-law. I said, what are we going to do? He said, well, we just prayed. Let's do the roof. And we started doing the roof, and the sun came out, and we got the roof done that day. And so whoever made the first move said, y'all, come on, let's move this stone. He said, roll the stone away. Come on, let's take the stone away. So they took the stone away. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Y'all, there's never a time that I sit down to take a meal that I don't say the blessing. Now, I don't always say, all right, y'all, let's pray. Sometimes if it's a big gathering of people and everybody's just kind of going at it, I whisper a prayer before I take that first bite. And then someone will say, are we going to pray? And it's kind of like an indictment. You're the preacher. Are we going to pray? What's wrong with you, Ron? And sometimes I say in defense, well, I prayed. But in other times I say, yeah, let's pray. And so we pray. Jesus always prayed, y'all. But he prayed out loud here, and he defined it. He said, Father, whenever I speak to you, I know you already hear me. You already know what I'm going to say before I say it. I'm praying out loud right now, Lord, and I'm not praying out loud for my benefit. I'm praying out loud for their benefit. I want them to know that this is your hand at work in this moment in the glory of what's about to happen. Lord, may they know that you sent me to this world, that you sent me to this tomb, that you sent me to this moment. And so it's framed, it's outlined. This is a God moment. This is a God moment. And when he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice. What did he say? Come out. Lazarus, come out. Theologians and commentators have said the reason he named him, if he had said, come out, all of the people in the tomb would have come walking out. But he called him by name. It was his dear friend. Come out. When he had said this, he called out, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped in strips of linen and cloth around his face. Looked to the people who were standing there, the very ones who had rolled the stone away, and he said, take off the grave clothes and let him go. That's a statement about how we ought to be helping each other follow Jesus. We ought to be looking out for each other. Because when Jesus saves us, when he calls us forth from spiritual death, we're wrapped up in death clothes, if you will. There are things that need to change, and we need each other's help in seeing those things become untangled from around us. And so Jesus is calling them to be involved in helping Lazarus to go forward from this moment. But here are the things I want to say today, and I pray that God will use them in our lives. He had already been in the tomb for 4 days, which is another way, that's what Martha said when Jesus said, roll the stone away. Well, there's going to be a bad odor. Lord, this is worse than you realize. If we take the stone away, it's only going to reveal what's really happened. All of that was her way of saying, there's no use. It's over. What in your life today have you categorized as hopeless? What fits under the category of it's done, it's past? There's no turning back. It's over. 4 days of death. There's no pulse. Worse than that, decay has already set in. There's certainly no way that a decaying body can be brought back to life. There's no way that a sea could be opened up and people could cross over on dry ground. There's no way that bread could fall out of heaven and land on the desert floor and give you your daily bread. There's no way that a whole group of quail would land and allow you to walk over and pick them up. There's no way that these things can happen. Where there is God, there's always a way. When Jesus reaches in, there's no limit to what can happen. And somehow we need the Holy Spirit to help us to understand that what we have labeled as over is never over unless God says it's over. And Jesus said, take the stone away. The fact that they had rolled a stone in place. This is no little rock. This is a huge stone that had to be leveraged into place. And it would take brute force to roll it back out of its resting place as it was in a track that rolled it over against the entrance so no wild animals could get in and desecrate the bodies that were laid to rest. This was no small act that was being called for when he said, roll the stone away. The stone represented the fact that they had no expectations of anything ever being any different than they were. When they stepped to the entrance of the tomb at the command and the invitation of Jesus and they rolled the stone away, it was a declaration of faith. It was an opportunity for God to reach into their impossible situation and do what nobody ever thought could happen. And all of us have those stories from our lives where we asked God, we asked Jesus to reach in, and He did. And He worked a miracle by His grace. A miracle that causes us still to stand in awe and wonder, wow, how in the world is he so different? How in the world could she have had that need met in her life? God reaches in beyond all of impossibilities and against all reason, and he reaches in and he does what only God can do. Jesus said a prayer and he called Lazarus by name. The thing that is so awesome about reading these Bible accounts of the interactions that Jesus had with people, no two are exactly the same. Have you noticed that? And yet we want to formulate everything. We think it always has to happen this way if God's going to work a miracle. You got to pray this way. You got to do this. You got to give yourself to these rituals. If it's real... I was reading this week, and the writer of the book that I'm reading said, and I think I shared this in Wednesday Bible study, Becky says, you already told that. Well, I talked to so many people, I can't remember who I told what. So if I tell you something more than once, just forgive me. So the first miracle that's recorded in Matthew after the Sermon on the Mount is the healing of a leper. I shared this Wednesday night. Leprosy was an awful disease. It rendered a person unclean because it was very contagious. And so the law declared that if you had leprosy, that if you walked into the company of people, you had to declare yourself unclean to give them a fair opportunity to keep their distance. Okay? When COVID was going on and she was not wearing a mask and it was rampant, what did you do? Well, keep my distance from her. The person who had leprosy was not allowed to have social contact with anyone. Think about this. If this guy's had leprosy for an extended time, he has not been in a gathering like this. He's not been at family gatherings. He's not felt a human touch for however long he's had this dreaded condition. When Jesus healed the leper, he walked over. The leper said, if you will, you can make me clean. That's what he said to Jesus. And Jesus said, oh, I'm willing. And then he walked right over and he touched him. And when he touched him, the scripture said, now Jesus is unclean until he goes through the cleansing rituals. Jesus didn't care about the rituals. He wanted this man to understand, not only are you healed from leprosy, but now you are released from all of the shame that came along with leprosy. I am touching you because I want you to know that not only is your health being restored, but your dignity is being restored. Is that powerful? The very next guy that gets healed, or girl, no, guy, a ruler's servant, the ruler comes to Jesus and said, my servant is in a really bad way, and he needs your healing touch. And Jesus said, show me the way. And he said, well, now, wait a minute. He said, I know you're busy, and I know that you're a man that has authority, and I'm a man who has authority over people, and I can say to this person, go here and do that, and to another, go there and do the other. And he said, they have to obey my command because of the authority that I have over them. If you just speak the word, I know my servant will be made well. And Jesus, when the man said that, said, I have not seen such great faith in all of Israel. This is amazing that this guy believes to the extent that he says you don't have to go there, you don't have to touch him, all you have to do is speak the word and I know that he will be made well. And Jesus said, may he be well. May he be raised up from his sickness. And the man went home and found out at the very hour that Jesus spoke the healing command, the servant was made well. Now here's what I want us to see. One person he touched, another one he healed from a distance. Every person in the sight of God is an individual who has a particular need, who has who needs something from him that in some small way or some large way is completely different than the last person. What I'm saying to you is God knows us individually. He knows how to reach into our lives. He knows how to meet us in the moment and bring to completion the miracle that we need to experience in our lives. And so it's not a formula. Some people have said, if you don't go to the altar, you won't receive the touch. You won't be saved or you won't be healed. You won't receive the touch that God is wanting to bring to your life. Someone says, if you don't go to church, you'll never know the miraculous power of God in your life. And none of that is true. Because Jesus himself said to the woman at the well who said, where do I worship? You Jews worship in Jerusalem at the temple. We Samaritans worship God on the mountain. Where do we worship? He said, a time is coming and has come when you'll not worship God in Jerusalem or on the mountain, but you will worship him in spirit and in truth. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing is an opportunity to be the very sanctuary of the presence of God, because Paul, in writing to the Corinthian church, said, you are the temple of the living God. God knows us. And today he's reaching into our lives and he's saying, roll the stone away. Now let me reach in. Now let me do what nobody else is able to do. Now watch what happens with the impossible. When the hands of the one who brought you into being to begin with reaches in and fashions a miracle in your life. Who God is and what God does is beyond what we can catalog. We'll study it all the days of our life and we still will only scratch the surface of who he is and what he does. We ought to keep studying, because the more we know of him, the sweeter our lives are. But having said that, whatever you know of God, whatever you've come to know of God in your lifetime, is not even the beginning of who he is and what he's able to do. I pray today that Jesus steps to the entrance of our tombs, to the entrance of our lives, and that we would hear him speaking to the Father in our behalf. The scripture says that Jesus is ever making intercession for us at the right hand of the Father. I pray today that we would know that Jesus is for us, that he's in our corner, that he wants to bless us. And some of us are the ones who are called to be there to encourage the miracle by rolling the stone away. I don't know if Martha had a hand on the stone. I don't know. Maybe she did. Maybe she stood back with tears and marveled at how everybody rallied to that moment, how they experienced the presence of Jesus. I mean, there was just something about it when he said, you roll the stone away. There was something that happened in the hearts of people that caused them to move to that stone and participate in what was about to happen. Makes me think of just this morning, we anoint Anne and Gazella, and we pray for them. And you came to roll the stone away. You came and put a hand on the shoulder of the person closest to you, and we became a part of a network of faith in that moment. We became a part of a family that says, I believe in what God is able to do. I believe that God can move in these lives in such a way that as we come together again, we'll say, this is Bethel. This is the house of God. God is in this place, and He's making His presence known. Lord, help us to know we're not just here talking about Him, but we are here with Him. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. What have you done? Will you roll the stone away? What has not changed and seems to never change, and you long for it to change? Will you lay it at His feet this morning? And even if in this moment, like Martha, you're saying, Lord, if you had, I wouldn't be where I am now. Here we are. Whatever got us here to this place in this moment, here we are. And He is here. Let's let Him have His way with us this morning to heal us, to deliver us, to sweeten us, to embolden us. Whatever it is that needs to happen in me, in you, in you, in you, in you, whatever needs to happen. Four days of death is no match for the call of Jesus. It's not over. It's not over. Whatever it is in your life, it's not over. There's a reason to roll the stone away. Here's the thing. If Jesus had wanted to, don't you know that he could have spoken to the stone and it would have moved? It's not like He needed anybody's help. Amen? It's not like He needed anybody's help. But they needed to be a part of what He was doing. They needed to be a part of what He was doing. It would forever change them. For years, they would gather and have a meal, and they would say, You remember that day in Bethany? I still can't believe it happened. I'm so glad I went over and helped move that stone. I'll never forget that. I'll never forget in that moment believing that He could, that He might, that it was not over, it was possible. I'm so glad I was a part of that. It changed me. I can hear them now. It represents what happens in our lives when we dare to believe with one another for what God's going to do next. There's someone on your heart right now, so I want us all just to bow and I want you to pray for that person who needs to be helped from their spiritual death, that they might walk new in the life that God has for them. Father, I pray this morning that we would never say never, because nothing is impossible with You. And just as Jesus prayed that day, not because He needed to inform you or because He needed to bolster His faith, but prayed so that those around Him might begin to participate in the glory of about what was to happen next. Lord, help us to live our lives in fellowship with one another in such a way that we are encouraging the reception of the glory of what You're wanting to bring to our lives in this day. There is no one beyond your touch. And help us to be numbered among those who believe it to the point that we're willing to go over and roll the stone away, whatever that figuratively means. Roll the stone away that you might have the next word in that person's life. Lord, I believe in miracles. I can't explain them. I don't understand your timing. I don't understand why this happens one time and another thing happens another time. But Lord, I have never lost the wonder of what happens when we trust you with our impossibilities. So will you touch us one more time? Will you move one more time? Will you help one more time? Will you bring to life one more time? Will you deliver one more time? Will you heal one more time? God, will you reach in? That we might know what Jesus meant when he said, it's impossible with men, but with God all things are possible. Let this be Bethel. Again today, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
It's not my life to live. It's not my song to sing. All I have is His for all eternity. It's not my righteousness. It's not my faithfulness. All I have is His for all eternity. We will crown Him, crown Him, King of glory.
We will crown Him, crown.